Let me do the introductions. Welcome to the INCA seminars. Today with us we have Nikolai Sinitsyn, who has been for a long time a researcher at Los Alamos National Laboratory. Nikolai, take it away.
Okay. My talk is Adiabatic Oracle for Quantum Computing, and this talk was done in collaboration with Bin Yen, who is now a staff member at Los Alamos National Laboratory, just as me. And I will start with my talk with somewhat. Okay, just why it does not switch. I will start my talk with somewhat criticizing quantum computing because I want to explain my motivation, but I promise that at the end I will be very positive, and basically I will show how to resolve all the problems that I will describe. But first I want to ask question whether the perfect quantum computer can deliver applications that we usually promise, like factoring large integer numbers or finding a solution to some complex constraint satisfaction problems. And I used to think that the answer to this question is no, that even if we have perfect device, we cannot do this. And there are separate reasons for different approaches to quantum computing. For example, for gate-based quantum computing and standard quantum algorithms, the problem with them is that at some point they assume that something is given for free. But in reality, if we look at what it takes to achieve this, we find that that we need some exponentially large additional resource, and even perfect computer cannot solve realistic problems. And similarly for D-Wave machine, it's kind of free from those problems. But the wave quantum computing is formally not mathematically justified. There is no proof that it works. And actually, there is growing evidence that it just in original form, it doesn't work. It needs some additions to the idea to solve problems faster. And let me just demonstrate initially what I mean for quantum annealing. I just remind that the goal is to find the ground state of some Eisenspin Hamiltonian with complex interactions. And quantum mechanical solution is to assume that those binary variables S are encoded by the projections of quantum spin operators, where spins are 1/2 of qubits. And in addition to this Hamiltonian, we add additional Hamiltonian that I will call mixing Hamiltonian, and its form is not important, but we assume that we somehow can easily prepare the ground state of this operator. Also, there is a coupling G, which is initially very large, so that system initially is prepared in the ground state of this Hamiltonian, and then we switch off the coupling adiabatically slowly to zero value. And then we can use adiabatic theorem to say that the initial ground state of the mixing Hamiltonian is adiabatically transferred to the ground state of the entire of the Eisen Hamiltonian at the end when this coupling becomes zero, and then we perform measurements and find the desired ground state. The problem here is that adiabatic evolution formally needs infinite time, but in reality we compete with classical computers, so we should perform this quantum annealing in finite time, and then we induce non-adiabatic excitations. Those excitations lead to computational mistakes, and the question is how many those mistakes we create. And recently, we actually were able to say something on this question. It looks like that this question is very hard because we deal with explicitly time-dependent and interacting problem with non-adiabatic transitions. But we published one article saying that this problem is in some sense exactly solvable. Namely, we found an annealing protocol for which we can characterize probability to obtain ground state and probability of any number of excitations just exactly and analytically. And we can do this both for adiabatic and non-adiabatic evolution. So we can basically see everything that is going on with the number of excitations as function of quantum annealing time. And in this solvable model, we assume that the mixing Hamiltonian is the projection operator on all spins points in a long x direction. So we assume that system is initially in this state, and the coupling decays with time as 1 over t. Here g is a parameter that describes deviation from the adiabatic approximation. And what I mean exactly solvable model, I mean that we still do not know how to solve the NP-complete problems. We do not find what is the ground state. Instead, we find only the probability of ground state and probability of excitations. So it's like we can fully characterize performance of this quantum annealing, but we still do not know what is the result that it produces. And our results were somewhat disappointing. Namely, the condition to find the ground state with probability one in this protocol for most complex problems was found to be linearly proportional to the number or to the size of the phase space, basically to the number of possibilities through which we search. So time is given by n times some characteristic time. This characteristic time is just inverse bandwidth of this Hamiltonian. And this result is purely classical. It says that to find the ground state of our regionalizing spin Hamiltonian, no matter how complex it is, we need time which is proportional to the size of the phase space. And this is the same as for classical Monte Carlo random search in the same problem. Also, we looked at non-adiabatic evolution when annealing time is restricted. Then we could derive exact formula for our model for the number of excitations that we produce. And we found that this number is suppressed by annealing time, but quite slowly. And this result also has purely classical interpretation. It's the same performance as what we expect from a purely classical random search during restricted time TA. So it looks like there is a growing evidence that standard quantum annealing approaches do not work unless we do something to improve them. Also, let me discuss standard quantum computing algorithms and a good example of Grover's algorithm. Its goal is to search through an unsorted array of data, and those records in those arrays have indices. And imagine that we are given some records and our goal is to find the corresponding index. And then it looks like the only way classically is to just check those records one by one, and eventually we find the our record and find its index. And this is scaling linearly with n, this number of records that we have. But quantum mechanically, we can accelerate this process if we assume that we can encode those indices in orthogonal quantum states k. And then Grover's algorithm assumes that we have access to an oracle. An oracle is kind of a black box to which into which we send this state psi. And in the output, we obtain almost the same state, but with minus signed in front of the amplitude of the searched state. Now, if we have this oracle operation, then Grover showed that we can obtain the desired record in square root of n steps. So it's considerable speed up. But you can see that there is a problem here if you try to specify the problem. For example, We encounter such situation in quantum annealing. I mean, we have a Hamiltonian, and we can think about its eigenvalues as those records, and indices are corresponding eigenstates. And then imagine that somebody gives us some very complex Hamiltonian and says, can you find the eigenstate that corresponds to some specific eigenvalue? And then we would say, yeah, we can use Grover Oracle to do this quickly. And for this Grover's algorithm, but for this we should produce the Grover's Oracle. But how we produce it if we have only original Hamiltonian? What we can do with it is maybe to implement evolution of our quantum state with time, but all those states have different energies, so all of them very quickly acquire different phases, everything dephases, and we get something very different from this Oracle operation. So it's unclear how to generate this Oracle for this particular problem. And the main result of our work is that we actually found that this, by means of quantum annealing, we can produce such desired unitary operators for big class of computational problems, basically for all famous NP complex problems. So this is the idea, that kind of general idea for the approach is that we use quantum annealing not to search for the ground state of a Hamiltonian, but to generate oracle that points to this ground state, and then we use the Grover's algorithm to find final solution. So it's kind of a hybrid approach that uses ideas from quantum annealing and from conventional quantum algorithms. So again, this idea is not entirely new, but what we did is actually found how to implement it in practice. And here, let me show how we propose to do this using specific example of a partition problem. This is the simplest known NP-complete problem. And its goal is to partition a set of integers from S1 to Sm into two subsets, big S1 and big S2. And sum of integers in first subset should be equal to the sum of the integers in the second subset. So this is the task. And partition problem is actually quite important in practice. I will not go to those details. And we can specify it mathematically if we introduce binary variables sigma I, where I is index of one of those integers, and this binary variables equals to plus one if this integer belongs to the first subset, and it equals to minus one if this integer belongs to the second subset. And then our goal is to find the solution of this simple linear equation in which we should find binary variables that satisfy this constraint, where Sk is our original set of integers. So this looks like a very simple problem, but it's surprisingly complex. And generally, if you want to solve it exactly and definitely, then we should simply search through all possibilities, and it takes of order of 2^m steps. Now, to set it into a suitable quantum mechanical problem, we again just interpret those binary variables as eigenvalues of Pauli operators. And then we can say that our goal is to find the eigenstate of this simple Eisen-Hamiltonian that corresponds to zero eigenvalue. So it looks very simple, but problem here is that zero eigenvalue is not the ground state of this Hamiltonian. So it's somewhere in the middle of the spectrum. So we cannot use standard quantum annealing just to find this eigenstate, we still can use quantum annealing if we notice that this Hamiltonian, that we can create square of this original Hamiltonian, and then zero eigenvalue of this one corresponds to the ground energy of this squared Hamiltonian, because it has known negative spectrum. But here we have two problems. One problem is that to create something like this, we have to induce all-to-all interactions of our qubits, and this is very hard in practice. And second, we still do not have mathematical proof that we have a protocol that definitely outperform classical algorithms, not in statistical sense, but in the sense of finding definite exact solution. So we will not go into this approach, which is often used for this kind of constraint satisfaction problem. And instead we propose a different one. So let's again start with our original Eisenspin Hamiltonian. I will call it original Eisenspin Hamiltonian. So we want to find its zero eigenvalue. And for this, we add just one additional spin. I will call it ancillary spin. And we assume that this ancillary spin interacts with all other spins as Eisen-Hamiltonian, in which this spin interacts with all others. And couplings are just our integer numbers that we should partition. Also, one addition is that this ancillary spin is not a qubit, but it's a quantum spin one. So it has three different eigenvalues. This operator has minus one, zero, and one, and it will be important later. Now, this interaction is already not that complex. It actually encounters in real physical systems. For example, in Vicenta in diamond has electronic spin one, which is coupled to nuclear spins. And it's known that this coupling is Eisen-like. So we have real physical system where this happens and nuclear spins practically do not interact with each other. Also, in addition to these interactions, we assume that we can apply external magnetic field that acts on our ancillary spin, but does not act on our computational qubits. And again, this is possible, like in the Vicenta, in diamond, nuclear spins have very small G factor, so we can disregard the interaction with magnetic field. Then we assume that we perform quantum annealing. So this field has a component along x-axis, which is very large initially. So we prepare a system in this spin, ancillary spin in eigenstate of this field initially, and then we switch this field off adiabatically or quasi-adiabatically. Now, one additional difference from standard quantum annealing is that when this field is large, the ground state would correspond to spin with projection minus one, but instead we start with eigenstate with projection zero. So our initial state is arbitrary state of computational qubits psi times the eigenstate of our ancillary spin on the field direction that initially points along x-axis with zero projection. Now, to see what's going on with this Hamiltonian, you can notice that it's actually trivially solvable mathematically because we do not have any term that would flip our computational qubits. So it means that if the state psi is initially eigenstate of our original Eisenspin Hamiltonian, then the state does not change during the evolution, and we can replace basically this Eisen Hamiltonian by corresponding eigenvalue. So the entire this large Hamiltonian is becomes effectively then equivalent to a Hamiltonian in which we have simply time-dependent magnetic field acting on our ancillary spin one. This field has a time-dependent component along x-axis, where field just decays as in standard quantum annealing, and also it has constant component along z-axis. And this component depends on our external fields that we can control, BZ. And also it depends on the corresponding eigenvalue of our original Eisen-Hamiltonian. Now here is the reason why we chose spin one. The reason is that during quantum annealing, if we start with zero projection along the fields, and we that this field changes, but we remain in the zero projection of our spin one. But this Hamiltonian actually has the instantaneous eigenvalue for this state equals always to zero. So basically, dynamic phase cannot be generated. I remind that dynamic phase is just instantaneous eigenvalue times time. And instantaneous eigenvalue is zero, and this is independent of whatever field we applied and whatever is the eigenvalue of this Hamiltonian. So the result during this evolution, we do not induce any dephasing. The only phase that we can induce is geometric phase, and it's actually also hard to induce during this evolution, because the very first article by Berry about Berry phase showed that if we have such initial conditions, then for cyclic evolution of the field, we do not induce Berry phase if we start with zero projection of integer spin on the initial field. But our field does not change cyclically. So it starts pointing initially along x direction, and then we switch off its x component. So at the end, our field points along either z direction if this combination of parameters is positive, or it points at the end along opposite to z direction if this combination of parameters is negative. And if we calculate what is the difference of phases that we induce for those two paths, we find that this difference is precisely pi. And this phase pi difference is protected topologically. So it does not depend actually on how we switch off this coupling, and does not require actually perfect precision of parameters that we have here. So it's topologically protected. As a result, if we perform such quantum annealing, then if we apply it to our original state with zero projection of our ancillary spin along x-axis, then at the end, our ancillary spin will point along z axis, having the same zero projection. But the state of computational qubit will be acted by unitary operator, which is very simple for eigenstates of our original Hamiltonian with positive value of this combination of parameters. We will change sign. We will not change sign of the amplitude. And when this parameter combination is negative, then for all such corresponding eigenstates, we change sign by minus one. So this looks already very close to the Grover's oracle, but it's not yet, because we want to change sign of only the state with zero value of this parameter En. And we can do this by performing quantum annealing twice, initially by setting this the value of this parameter B equal to 1/2. Then we mark by minus sign all amplitudes of states with non-positive eigenvalues. Then we repeat this quantum annealing step and mark by minus sign all states below zero, this energy below zero eigenvalue. So as a result of those two steps, we obtain just precisely our Grover's oracle that changes sign of only states with zero eigenvalues. So this is basically the idea of how we generate Grover's oracle for this problem. I want to just mention that this idea can be generalized to many more complex problems, like if we want to satisfy many such linear constraints simultaneously, it's totally possible. We can generate Grover's oracle for all of them and sequentially satisfy all such constraints still during square root of n number of steps. Also, we can easily include constraints of the form where some linear form of qubits of our binary variables is less than some integer threshold. And this is even easier to do because we need only one quantum annealing step to generate oracle. And also in our article, we show that it's easy also to satisfy constraints in which we want to find minimum of certain linear form in addition to all such constraints. And usually such problems are already hard to solve by classical computers, even approximately. So it means that this type of problems includes practically all famous computational problems that we know. Also, Grover's algorithm needs diffusion step, but diffusion step is very similar in structure to the Grover's oracle unitary operation. We do not need additional hardware to do this. If we have those interactions, we can generate diffusion step just changing external field and performing similar quantum annealing. So it can be done just within the same framework. So before conclusion, I have a few comments. First comment is how quickly we can implement this quantum annealing. And this is very important. It turns out that during this our quantum annealing, we always have a finite gap because those eigenvalues of our original Hamiltonian are always integer numbers. So if we set those fields to be fractional numbers, we always have finite gap. And we can prove that non-adiabatic excitations will be suppressed exponentially this time of quantum annealing. So we can prove that in order to guarantee that our accuracy of quantum annealing is sufficient to go through all square root of n steps of Grover's algorithm without breaking up the solution, time of annealing should scale only logarithmically with number of states that we through which we should search. So this does not add physically much time to time to implement the entire Grover's algorithm, so it still remains scaling as square root of n. Unfortunately, the scaling is not exponential by standard definition, but it's still exponential in the sense that time to find the desired solution is decreased by a number which is exponentially large, by a factor which is exponentially small, actually. And therefore, for such problems that I described, usually quantum supremacy can be achieved for just 50 qubits with something like of order of 1 million steps of Grover's algorithm. Also, one interesting observation that we made is that it would be hard to implement our approach in completely gate-based quantum computer. One can think that we can easily simulate quantum annealing step using just quantum gates, but it turns out that we need very high precision for those simulations because Grover's algorithm is repeated, has repeated square root of n steps. So in order for, so the accuracy of simulation of just one quantum annealing step should be of order of one divided by square root of n. And it means that we need the order of square root of n quantum gates to simulate our quantum annealing using, for example, Suzuki-Trotter decomposition in order to achieve desired precision. And then the square root of n is multiplied by square root of n of steps in the Grover's algorithm. So the entire process would scale actually linearly with n, which is classical scaling. So it looks like that on gate-based quantum computer, our approach is not does not have any advantage. So we probably should rethink about just what should be right implementation of quantum computer. That maybe our approach is in some sense better. So this is my conclusion. So we propose some kind of hybrid approach that uses ideas of quantum annealing and gate-based quantum computers, but our approach does not need universal quantum gates. We do not need anything like full connectivity between qubits. We need just one spin coupled to all other qubits. And again, we can, if we implement such a Hamiltonian, we need something like 50 qubits with of order of 1 million elementary quantum annealing steps in order to achieve quantum supremacy. So I also mentioned articles. We submitted 2 articles for publication, but still work with referees, but they are available in archive. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you. Please ask questions if you have.
Yeah, thanks for the great talk. Are there any questions?
So I have one.
Yes, were you going to say something?
No. It's strange that I already gave this talk a couple of times, just at conferences. And somehow it was audience was silent, so I still do not know why.
I think it's fairly common to take a moment to process what we heard. Also, I think most of the audience of the seminar will actually watch this in the recording. But let me try to channel them and ask you the questions that they may have.
Yeah, sure.
So first of all, for an NPA hard problem, there is essentially the polynomial circuit that is used to verify a solution. So the solver to the NPA hard problem provides the solution, but then there's a polynomial circuit that verifies it, right?
Yeah.
So, like, for example, if you have a bunch of numbers that need to add to zero, then there is a circuit that is just does the summation, right?
Yeah.
So this is a classical circuit, but clearly you could just kind of make it a reversible circuit and put it into a quantum computer.
Yeah.
So, and that in principle would let you implement a Grover oracle. So can you comment on the comparison between what you're doing here and that implementation?
To be honest, I've never heard that we can easily generate oracle like this. I should learn what you mean here. Because to my knowledge, this is a big problem, how to generate oracles for Grover's algorithm, and it's usually considered. So there is actually recent article saying that in cases when oracle is easy to design, like as a quantum socket, if we can simulate it quickly on classical computers, then the entire problem is likely solvable by classical computer quickly. So that article actually claims that computationally hard problems, they are represented by oracles that are represented by very long circuits, quantum circuits. So it actually can be very hard to design them.
But again, we do not disagree
with them, because we showed that it's kind of hard to implement our oracle on gate-based quantum computer, that we need really long circuit.
Let's get back to this. I see that there is a question in the audience.
Mm-hmm.
We can't really hear anything. Maybe you can type it out in chat.
Okay. Let's see. Yeah, Zoom was updated, so I'm not sure that I
see. Yeah, no, I'm asking the person in the audience. Okay, while we wait for that, so let me see if I get this right. So the second question that I had is about this adiabatic theorem that you apply at some point. So that you say that there's a constant gap. And presumably, when you do your algorithm, there is some error still. And then you say that there has to be exponential. Oh, yes, sorry. Okay, I think we got our question.
Mm-hmm. Hello?
Please go ahead.
Can you hear me now?
Hello?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. Sorry. There's echo. Okay, I think I use my phone. So is it better? The echoes? Can you hear me?
Yes, everything seems to be working now.
Okay, sorry. I'm from Navy Postgraduate School at Monterey, California. I'm new to this community here. I have a question. So back to your slide one, the very beginning about the adiabatic Hamiltonian, that equation. Okay, next one. Yes. So my question is, this is, you're saying, so the T, when T start with zero, you're starting with HM, right? Or with HI?
Yes. With HM, G is very large. So basically this term completely dominates. So you can see that as T goes to zero, this coupling is very large, so we can disregard the size and spin part. So we start with mixing Hamiltonian.
Okay, you start with mixed Hamiltonian and then you go to the IC, right? Which is kind of like diagonal somehow, like in terms of the look of the matrix. And so then it corresponded to those constraint optimization. Now, is there, in practice, is there a way to backwards, like you're starting with a diagonal Hamiltonian, and then when time goes up, you become more mixed, and then how do I use your algorithms in that case? Well, is that not possible? I mean, like in your community, does people use some kind of backwards?
Sometimes people talk about it because for this specific problem, I mean, this is how it's specified. This is a goal that we assume that we have some mixing Hamiltonian, which is relatively simple. But we want to find ground state of complex, so direction is defined. But again, the similar ideas I used for other purposes, like we can formally prepare all quantum gates using such purely adiabatic evolution. And then this kind of questions become kind of also interesting, just if we prepare some number of spins in some simple states, and then what is the protocol that produces a certain entangled state of those spins. But this is kind of different topic. It's like, it's about holonomic quantum computing. So all this. So it's more about how to implement certain quantum operations, not about how to solve the, not about quantum algorithms themselves.
Yeah, okay. So, but then once H is defined, so once H is defined, you can the rest of your the rest of the algorithm and the theory applies the same. Am I correct? The global oracle and the system works the same, right? As long as I know the format, or it restricts to this kind of specific format, form to apply the theory that you have today.
Yeah, well.
Do you understand? Like if I have a different format of HT, would it apply the same way?
Yeah. Well, formally the idea of quantum annealing is that this HI can be anything. It can have very complex interactions, maybe not only binary couplings, but arbitrary. So idea in principle works that if we switch off coupling adiabatically, then we can prepare the ground state. The problem is more like how to make it quickly, because we are never in the adiabatic regime in such systems. And it turns out to be very hard. That actually there are indications that performance of such idea just without some additions that I described later, that performance of this idea just in this simple form is not actually better than performance of classical algorithms. But I showed that with some with some ideas, we can still use similar ideas that we perform some kind of quantum annealing, but to generate Grover's oracle instead of just generate ground state of Eisen-Hamiltonian. So this was the idea.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
All right. And I wanted to finish asking the question that I was going to ask, which is that adiabatic evolution also has some error. So you showed that for the digitizing, the error has to be really small, but what about the adiabatic evolution? Does that error also has to be exponentially small?
The problem is, but it's standard problem. Why, for example, this idea does not work in this form usually? It's because gaps, even if Eisenspin Hamiltonian, if it's digitized, even if it has a gap in its spectrum, when we perform this evolution, this gap somewhere closes. It becomes maybe finite, but exponentially small. And non-adiabatic excitations are inevitable. And usually it's not just gap closes for just two levels, it closes simultaneously for many states, so we end up somewhere far away from the ground state. But for our Hamiltonian, it was constructed, so you can see that this interaction, those parameters, so this part is just has eigenvalues which are integer numbers, and magnetic field here, even if we forget about X component, this component is always integer number or half integer number if we make BZ half integer. So this gap is always finite. And when it's finite, then non-adiabatic excitations, we can provide protocols that will definitely work. It's I mean, this, people should be careful a little bit, but this is general result for theory of non-adiabatic transitions, that if we have a finite gap, then excitations are suppressed basically as exponent minus this gap divided by this some actually gap squared divided by a sweeping rate. And we can show that that if time of evolution of this annealing scales linearly with number of qubits, then the probability of this non-adiabatic excitation will scale just will be exponentially suppressed.
I see. So you're not actually using the adiabatic theorem. You're using some other result where there's this exponential dependence on the gap.
So when we have one gap is finite, we can always choose a protocol. Yeah, if during the entire protocol it's finite, then we can guarantee that we will not produce non-adiabatic excitations with exponentially up to exponentially small.
What is this result that you're using as the reference for it?
Well, it's called Tychonieff formula. It's kind of well known. But if you look at our article that I cited, I actually in second article I intentionally wrote we actually wrote. Sorry, it's I have co-author. So we wrote. Appendix where we just devoted to this kind of theory of non-adiabatic excitations for spin one and time-dependent fields. So it's nothing new there, but people are usually not. It's not easy to find literature on this. So we just wrote special appendix where I tried to be a kind of pedagogical to explain.
I see, thanks. So are there any other questions? Right, so let me just for the record explain this idea that about how to implement oracles that I don't know, there's probably some sort of assumption or a special circumstance for the paper that you mentioned, which prevents them from using this idea. But the idea is relatively simple. For any NP problem, there is a verifier circuit, which is by definition polynomial. It is a classical circuit that returns zero or one, depending on a bit string. What you do with this circuit is that you can turn such a circuit into a quantum circuit that condition on a bit string will apply either one or minus one phase. So that's just quantization of a classical computation. It's like a standard method. And supposedly if your classical computation was just precise, right, then if you implement all the gates precisely in that quantization, you also get a precise implementation of the oracle. So I will need to look at this result that you quoted that says that some oracles are supposed to be hard to implement. I don't know what exactly their assumptions are, but yeah, I think this idea is relatively well known. And when people discuss various things like solving Bitcoin with a quantum computer, they rely on this idea.
I see what you mean, but again, usually we should be careful with quantum computing because something looks trivial, like polynomially easy, but in reality, somewhere there is assumption which is actually not easy to implement, the circle. I should double check, but I know that this is hard problem to generate oracles.
All right, so let's stop the recording here. And thank you for the talk and see you next week.
Okay, thank you.